I'll say, David, I'm in New York. Why
all
are
right,
we
all right, doing all this? Right. All right, we're rolling, by the way. I just wanted to check my levels. It's very sad that I have to do all this, but my producer, Alex Brazell, he's in Spain right now.
Okay.
Yes, I'm doing everything by myself. And by the way, he lives at 501 Clingston Street in Edgewater, New Jersey. He leaves the back door open, and if he's got a Ty Cobb rookie card framed above his bed. If anybody wants to take a look at it, it's.
I love that you just put his personal address on blast.
Well, you know, I know that he would want people to come to his place, 501 Clingston Avenue, back door wide open. He's away for 2 weeks, and there's a Ty Cobb rookie card above his bed, and everybody should see it. Hey, are you still there?
Yep, I'm here, man.
This is exciting. This is so exciting. The White House Correspondents Dinner is tomorrow, Saturday. Hasan Minhaj from The Daily Show. What are you doing?
Nothing.
What are you doing?
Oh, I closed the window. Sorry about that.
Oh, you closed a window.
Yeah.
That's a good thing, because...
Be distracting, yeah.
Well, you know what? A lot of people defenestrate in the middle of an interview with David Feldman.
Don't take it so personally, David. I was trying to make it better.
Oh, okay. But if you do defenestrate, hold on to the phone so we can hear. We had Brody Stevens. Brody Stevens peed on the show last
perfect,
week.
Perfect. There you go.
So if you
so
could,
at least I was not. I was only defenestrating. I mean, it's yes. Not even. Yeah.
I'm
not even in the same league.
Many people accuse me of chronic defenestration, and. This is why nobody listens to my show. Can I do the introduction, please, without you jumping out the
please,
window?
Please, okay.
Thank
please,
you.
By all means.
Thank you.
By all means.
What was my that? Apologies. What was that?
My apologies.
What was that sound?
That was me apologizing.
Yeah, but there was like the, okay. The what? You opened the window again, didn't you?
There are two windows open. I closed one.
This is turning out to be the greatest interview I've ever done.
We're off to the. There you go. All right. Okay. Both windows are now closed.
Okay, we're now.
We will not hear the ambient parking. Sorry, the honking of New York City anymore.
All right. 15 minutes into the interview, it's now time for my audience to know who I'm talking to. The White House.
Wait, what about the defenestration? You forgot about addressing that.
You know what? I'm going to jump out the window if you don't be quiet. The White House Correspondents Dinner is tomorrow, Saturday. Hasan Minhaj from The Daily Show will be performing. Unfortunately, I couldn't get Hasan Minhaj. I tried, but there's bad blood between me and The Daily. I don't know. Something, I don't know. He doesn't return my calls. Instead, we have one of the guys writing for Hasan Minhaj.
This is about as bad as it gets. I also do security for him, and I'm his driver. And I'm his driver.
We have his writer, Azhar Usman. He's a comedian, actor, and writer. He's one of the stars of the new Amazon series, Patriot, which has been renewed for a second season. He's toured over 25 countries as a comedian. Dave Chappelle calls him untouchable, which is why Azhar has opened for Dave.
Azhar, you keep fucking it up, man. It's Azhar, but that's all right. David, go ahead, please.
Azhar.
Continue. Yes, I just want to make it the worst introduction at this point in the history of the David Feldman podcast.
Dave please, Chappelle. Continue. Dave Chappelle calls Azhar. He calls you Azhar behind your back.
And that's where you got it from? I got
yeah,
you.
And he calls so. You he calls Azhar untouchable.
Untouchable. Untouchable.
Untouchable.
Spanish. I don't know if this is a fake laugh. Are you real laughing?
Yeah. But that's all the time. We're all out of time. We're all out of time.
Right.
Thank
you. It's been wonderful to be with you.
Thanks for doing
this. I really appreciate it. I really appreciate it.
So thank you for doing this. So let's start off with the White House Correspondents Dinner. How do you sleep at night? Supporting.
Man, it's been very difficult, to be honest with you.
But it's wrong. It's immoral. The White House Correspondents Dinner is immoral, and you shouldn't be going there, even if Trump isn't showing up.
Well, how do you figure that it's immoral?
Because it's self-aggrandizement. It's the press wasting millions of dollars celebrating themselves when they should be out covering Trump, covering the crimes that are being committed in our name. Instead, they've turned this into their own Academy Awards. Aren't we great? And then they go, oh, but we have a couple of scholarships for young reporters. It's BS. It's got to come to an end, and you have to draw a line in the sand, my friend, and boycott tomorrow's White House Correspondents. You and Hassan, get me Hassan on the line. He needs to cancel at the last minute and send a
signal. Oh, my God, how amazing would that be?
He needs to send a signal that this has to stop. It has to stop.
I don't know how much of this is you being 100% serious. I know that there's some, clearly, there's some sincere content behind what you're saying. but I feel like it's 90-10, like 90% bullshit, 10%. Serious, but I mean, look, to answer your question, how do I sleep at night? I mean, it's not because of the moral dilemma, it's because of the pressure to navigate a freaking minefield of all these competing considerations with all the, you know, there's a lot of tension, man. Trump's not coming. He's basically prohibited anybody from his administration from attending. And so trying to make, you know, the people in the room laugh, but also keeping an eye towards the fact that anybody who watches it really will watch it online later. And how do you write a killer set for that context has been, it's been an interesting challenge, man.
Yeah, I guess.
You've written for these like award shows and stuff for other people, right?
I don't think I ever wrote for a White House Correspondents Dinner. It's a tough one because normally you have to go on after the president.
Right.
Which is just...
a little less pressure for that reason. That's one good thing.
Right. You don't have to follow the president. Although, did you see the Al Smith dinner last year?
I feel like I did not see it last year.
Well, the Al Smith dinner for our listeners around the world, and we do have listeners around the world.
Nice.
The Al Smith
all dinner. Six of them. Was six of them?
All seven? Six.
Got it.
Seven if you include the former KGB. They listen to everything I do.
They're listening to everything.
Yeah, they listen to everything. So the Al Smith dinner is held every year at the Waldorf. It's for the Catholic Church. Al Smith was a...
Yeah, I did see that. Yes, I did see that. With when Trump and Hillary both went up.
Yes.
Yes.
Go
ahead, sorry.
It was remarkable because Hillary was, you know, in the ballpark funny. She took some jokes from her writers and she told them, and she's not an intrinsically funny person the way Obama was or McCain was funny. But she did okay. And then Donald, he's an expert on everything. He knows everything. So he just got up there. He didn't need writers. And it was amazing to watch.
Yes.
So tone deaf, yes. So wrong, so bad, which is surprising because he's got the moves of a comedian when he does one of his rallies, right? He's kind of...
Yeah, oh no, absolutely. I remember watching his set on that and thinking like, man, he just had bad, you know, advice from comics or writers because whoever wrote those quote-unquote jokes for him just didn't play to his strengths and the fact that the guy is already inherently hilarious and is constantly, you know, just being himself, he's funny. Mm-hmm. He didn't need to dig so hard. He really started attacking Hillary and just the crowd turned on him really bad.
Right.
Anyway, it was a thing of beauty.
Yeah.
Watching this guy bomb in front of
the entire audience. Let's address the elephant in the room. You are
the camel in the room.
Well, I was going to make the fact that you're Indian.
I am Indian.
And you're on top of an elephant. That was the joke I was going to go for. But I like the camel in the room better. Let's address the camel in the room.
Shall we?
Yeah, let me...
Go ahead.
So, you are Muslim.
I am.
But you're from Indian parents.
Correct.
And I'm sorry... That would be Native Indian parents, right?
Well, if we say Native Indian, it makes people think Native American.
What happened? What did you break?
My boy Mo Ammer is in the room, and he's just like a bull in a china shop, dropping things and destroying the property. Mm-hmm. So he accidentally dropped something. I think he dropped some cologne on the desk. Okay. But he's leaving the room to make some
noise elsewhere. Quiet. He's going to make noise elsewhere. So if you live in India, and you're Indian,
yes,
sir. You would be a Native Indian.
That is correct.
Okay,
that is correct.
And yet you're Muslim. So why didn't you move to Pakistan? Why didn't your grandparents move to Pakistan when Lord Mountbatten
separated? Very good question. Fair question, man. So, well, first of all, just thank you for being aware of that history. And it's so funny to me because, you know, I grew up Muslim in the United States, complaining to my parents, like, you have no idea what it feels like to be a minority. And they're like, dude, we grew up Muslim in India. What the hell are you talking about? Yes, we do know what it feels like to be a minority. And it was not until I, you know, became an adult and ran the numbers and figured out, like, though Muslims in India are statistically a minority, it's such a big country that nominally the actual number of Muslims in India is huge. It's mm-hmm. like 100 and something million. And there are actually more Indian Muslims on earth than there are Arab Muslims combined.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, it's pretty insane.
Okay, let me ask you a question about this.
Mm-hmm.
Is it fair to say that the Muslims in India are doing better because they're a minority than they are in Pakistan, where they're the majority? Is there some empowerment that comes with being a minority?
I would say yes and no. I mean, the thing is, Muslims in India are, you know, kind of ghettoized in a lot of ways. And there's a lot of poverty. You know, Hyderabad is probably one of the largest states where there's a significant Muslim population. And it's, you know, kind of very similar and analogous to the way in our country we have a very clear racial divide mm-hmm. and access to resources. You know, the structural aspects of racism that limit access to education, housing, and economic opportunity, those same phenomena are alive and well across the planet. And so you can pick any minority group pretty much anywhere and you'll find a very similar type of dynamic. So India is no exception to that.
But you do have very successful Muslims living in India.
Yeah, and that's what I was about to say. Now, having said that, that might be the rule, but there are definitely, you know, a number of exceptional cases where you might have, you know, people rising to tremendous levels of prominence, either in business or academia or media or what have you.
Dave Chappelle called you untouchable. Untouchable in India would make you... I'm being serious.
Of course, I know. The caste system, yeah.
Well, if you're not going to treat me with respect... You have a legal degree, don't you?
I do. I used to be a lawyer, man. Wait, were you an attorney as well?
No, I'm going through a divorce, and I
oh,
just,
you are. I'm yes, sorry to
and
hear
I
that.
And I and yeah. just you so you know, as we go further into this interview, I am going to be disrespectful to you.
That's not, perfectly fine.
Not because I'm Jewish, and you're Muslim. It's because you're an attorney.
So, well, all I can say to that is Shabbat Shalom. Do
boy,
your thing.
Boy, you really are a sleazy attorney.
used to be. I'm a recovering attorney.
So just so the people listening, this is not resentment that you grew up in Skokie as a Muslim and your parents secretly encouraged the Nazis to march in Skokie. I know the truth. Don't even
joke about that.
I know. Were you alive? Were you born yet when they marched in Skokie?
No, I was not alive when they marched, but I was born in 1975.
Okay.
But I do distinctly remember when I learned about the whole history, because the Skokie Public Library, when I was in, I think, middle school or high school, had unveiled this Holocaust memorial outside the library, which was, of course, you know, expeditiously graffitied by some neo-Nazis with with a swastika. And then it became a whole, obviously, you know, new situation, and everybody was talking about it. And then in the midst of that whole controversy at that time, I, for the first time ever, just learned about all this incredible history. Skokie is the subject of, you know, a landmark Supreme Court case, a documentary film made about it, a feature film made about it. So I was like, oh my God, this is a very historic town. And it's interesting to me now as a comic, because it's like, that whole dispute was over free speech.
Right.
And it's interesting also that the ACLU at that time, this is how the country is completely flipped, represented the neo-Nazis.
Mm-hmm. Well, they still would.
They still would, exactly. But what I'm saying right
they are now. They would represent Ann Coulter, who's an original Nazi. She's an OG.
How weird would that be, the ACLU representing Steve Bannon as a Nazi?
But they would.
I know they would. Yeah.
They would.
Well, I mean, but that's, isn't that the heart of the whole argument that's happening?
Yeah, I have three.
Is hate speech free speech? That's the question.
Your Honor, I would like to control the line of questioning here.
Please.
Okay, so there are three areas that I want to talk about with you right now. I want to talk about Ann Coulter, freedom of speech.
Mm-hmm.
So write that down. We'll get to Ann Coulter in a second.
Okay.
I also want to talk about you saying, let's not joke about that. I kind of offended you when I said your parents invited the
supported the neo-Nazis.
Yeah, I want to talk to you about that in a second, sure. Because that's about political correctness and who can make jokes and who can't.
Yes.
But we glossed over something that's really important, and that was Lord Mountbatten, after World War II, he was kind of the emperor, well, not the emperor, but he was in charge of India. And he had to solve a problem. And the problem was, what do you do with the people of India, the Hindu and the Sikhs and the Muslims? And he, I believe, after World War II, came up with the idea of a partition. He said, we'll put... Are you still there?
I'm here. I'm listening. Yeah.
He said, we'll put the Hindus and the Sikh over here, and we'll create Pakistan and put all the Muslims over there. Is that how it worked?
Well, okay, I'm not going to pretend to be an expert on the political intrigue that took place at that time as to what led to the partition. Because,
well, then tell me about
did
Lord Mountbatten's wife bang Nehru?
That I can confirm with 100% certainty happened.
She was banging.
No, I'm just kidding. Idea, man.
Oh, Lord Mountbatten's wife was in India, and she was banging Nehru.
Nehru. Is that really confirmed?
Truth, and Mountbatten was the one who introduced Queen Elizabeth to Prince Philip, and the last name of the royal family should be Mountbatten. But they went with Windsor, which was like a slap in the face to Lord Mountbatten, who had a big influence on Prince Charles. And Lord Mountbatten was killed by the IRA. And the police are coming to get us because I know the truth.
Yeah, I can hear that. This is crazy.
Okay.
Wow. I need to look into this a lot more. Let me just say that India-Pakistan partition obviously is and probably will remain, you know, a hot button, very sensitive kind of political sensitivity on both sides. And then, of course, the religious component to it, you know, makes people even more hypersensitive. But I'll just tell you that I've heard too many different theories and, you know, stories behind the stories of what really happened and why did the partition happen and who wanted it to happen and what were the commercial interests behind it, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm just going to go on this one and say I don't really know what happened.
Mm-hmm.
I just feel like I feel about partition kind of the way I feel about 9/11. Like, I don't know what really happened, but I know I don't believe the official story.
But it was an outside job.
I don't know what really happened.
No, the partition was an outside job.
Well, I mean, that's the thing. There's theories about, you know, political intrigue between Jawaharlal Nehru and what's his name? You know,
Mountbatten.
The founder of Pakistan. Oh my God, this is so embarrassing. Neither of us is. They call him?
Stan.
Stan, that's right, Stan. What is it, Wiesenthal? No.
Stanley Wiesenthal.
Stanley Wiesenthal, I think.
Of course. You think they're going to trust a Muslim to start at their own country? You actually think the Pope is Catholic? They had to bring a Jew in. Do you think... Wait. You don't know about Bin Laden being Jewish?
It was Bin Laden. Benjamin Laden.
Come on, you think the Saudi Arabians, those princes, are going to trust one of their own to pull off something as complicated as 9/11? Originally it was 9/12. Originally it was 9/12. They said for you 9/11.
Actually, it would have been 9/10, but they're always a day late.
All right,
let's
move on. You said don't even joke about that.
Well, you know what it is? It's not that I could care less. I could take the joke. I'm afraid. See, the problem is if people don't get the joke, mm-hmm. then the joke is out of a context. And, you know, context is everything. And so, sadly, you know, I'm going to tell you about my own self now. You know, my own awareness and hyper-awareness around... You know, growing up in Skokie, man, my whole life I've been around Jewish people and have developed almost kind of like a, I'm an honorary member of the tribe, you know, like Nazi jokes, right. Hitler jokes, you know, people in our culture, I feel like in America, oftentimes without really the proper context will engage in some of these jokes.
Right.
And even if the joke on it, you know, just... in itself is a funny joke, and so it might be a well-constructed joke, but it's just highly insensitive, or it's mm-hmm. done in a way that doesn't acknowledge, you know, the energy and the feeling and the emotion behind it. And I've come to the conclusion, David, that, you know, context is everything, and also intention is everything.
Right.
Intent of the speaker.
And what is that called? Is that mens rea?
Mens rea, right, in the law, it's sort of the criminal mind, the criminal intent. That's more in the criminal context.
Right.
But just the subjective intent of the speaker, what's in their heart when they're saying X, Y, or Z, never gets talked about, man, in the debacles that happen when comics do edgy jokes and then end up offending somebody and then it turns into a situation and then they're pressed to apologize. We never end up discussing or exploring the subjective intent.
And that to me, but that to me is why censorship is so important and why I'm for censorship. And by you laughing, I just proved a point I'm about to make, and I'm being serious.
Okay.
We need censorship because I can say whatever I want on this show. And as long as people are laughing, it's okay. And what's happened is people like Ann Coulter and Rush Limbaugh will always say when they're caught saying something horrible, I was joking. I was joking. Mm. And once they say I was joking, then the intent is not to hurt, but to entertain. So I do believe that. And I'm being serious. Censorship in a civilized society, there's a reason we don't talk a certain way. Because we might offend somebody inadvertently. That's why language, and I sound so condescending right now to my audience, but language is important. Words we choose are important. That's why we have grammar police. That's why we have dictionaries. That's why we have laws. And in a civilized society, and it used to be this way, we don't make racial jokes. We don't make ethnic jokes. We don't do that in a civilized, polite society because it might offend somebody. But as the country gets dumber and dumber, the only wit at our disposal is ethnic humor, racial humor, and then we wrap it around the First Amendment as though it's something important instead of just plain stupid.
Well, I mean, it's an interesting take. I don't agree that the conclusion of it is we need censorship. I think that you might, your diagnosis might be on, but maybe your prescription is off.
Well, you know,
because can I tell you
sure,
why? Because,
sure.
Because you know, everything you just said about, you know, we don't do that in a civilized society. Well, first of all, people do that. They just do it behind closed doors.
That's okay.
Okay.
That's okay.
So you're saying censorship in the public sphere. We need to limit public speech.
I'm saying, first of all, I don't know if I believe this, and that's the danger of people like Ann Coulter and Rush Limbaugh saying things, spitballing, running up the flagpole to see if anybody salutes. The problem is, I'm just thinking out loud, and I shouldn't be thinking. And I shouldn't be thinking out loud in front.
You should not, because look, the question of censorship, right? This is at the heart, I would say, of really what the whole world is fighting about. You know, what does it mean to be a free society? And if you sacrifice one of the most cherished cornerstones of a free, liberal, open society, which is free speech, by trying to limit what people can say, you have literally sort of cut the legs out from underneath the very basis of why we are a free speech culture, why we are a First Amendment culture. Now, let me say this, though. I agree that hate speech is a problem. But what we have not resolved as a society, as a culture, and as a civilization is hate speech still free, protected speech or not? If it's not, we have to figure out what constitutes hate speech. And that's where the rubber meets the road, because it's highly contested, ambiguous, and virtually, therefore, impossible to resolve.
But a civilized... So, hang on for one second. Again, I emotionally, I believe this, not intellectually, but almost intellectually, I believe this. A civilized society knows what hate speech is. Remember the definition of pornography?
Right. I know it when I see it.
I know it when I see it. What has happened is the right wing, the conservatives, have been hijacked by racists, by people who believe that the Confederacy should have won the Civil War.
The so-called alt-right.
Yes, it's been hijacked. And they've turned everything into subjectivity, and everything revolves around the First Amendment. A civilized society has arrived at truths. Like, slavery is wrong. You don't persecute Arabs and Mexicans. A civilized society knows what's wrong and what's right. And so,
you can oppress Arabs in Israel. That's okay.
Well. You're a lawyer. You know that
it gets complicated.
No, you fight like a woman. You know that? You're not a lawyer.
Let's start talking about it, bro. This is a conversation that America needs to have. There are two conversations that the alt-right has forced on America.
But you brought up Israel. I want to go back to Ann Coulter and the First Amendment. Let's stay in America.
In
America. Because
Mexicans and Arabs. You can't oppress Arabs and Mexicans. You can't.
No, I'm talking about Ann Coulter's right to speak at Berkeley. First of all, she's being paid $20,000 by the YAF and Bridge USA. So it's not free speech. She's doing it for $20,000. She's doing it to provoke Berkeley. Why, you know, of all the places to speak in the Bay Area, why Berkeley? She's doing it as a cause celeb, and it costs $20,000 for her to come on campus, and then the protests, and then the protection. For what purpose? To increase the value of her quote-unquote brand.
Sure.
I don't want any part of it. We all know what this is about. It's not a slippery slope. She is a vile, disgusting pig. She's a racist. She justifies oppression of women, of Mexicans and Arabs. In any civilized society, she would be recognized as a purveyor of hate speech. What's the debate?
Well, hold on, but I would argue that, first of all, everything you just said is true. You're on a podcast right now with me saying that she is a vile, you know, a racist, etc. So she is being reviled. The only thing we're arguing is, should it be illegal? Should it be outlawed that she is not allowed to publicly say, you know,
I'm the chancellor of Berkeley. Yes, I know we get it's a public school. I get it. So the First Amendment is at play here because public funding.
Yes.
But as a radio show, as a podcast, I'm free to say you're not allowed on my show, and that's not a violation of her First Amendment. They're being slippery using the First Amendment because UC Berkeley is using government funds, so it's a First Amendment issue. But otherwise, it's not a First Amendment issue.
I mean, look, here's what it comes down to. I think this. I mean, this is a never-ending oceanic discussion, right? People have been debating this for hundreds of years, and they will continue to debate it probably for a very long time. But I think that the distinction we need to make is, what is the behavior we are interested in trying to regulate as a matter of law versus the behavior we are interested in regulating as a matter of just social courtesy, mores, norms, etc.? Everything you said about how a civilized society ought to be, you know, it should not be racist, it should not be, you know, sexist, it should not be xenophobic, it should not be anti-Semitic, it should not be anti-immigrant, it should not be Islamophobic, it should not be all of the things that we as civilized people have come to figure out. These are all isms that are destructive to the type of society that we all want, that civilized people want. I'm arguing that all of those things, as bad as they might be, ought to be regulated as a matter of social, you know, custom and mores, but they should not be turned into matters that we want to regulate as a matter of law when it comes to speech. You know, you can say racist things, but you cannot, but the law will regulate your action and not enable you to implement, you know, racist policy, for example, as an employer or what have you. So we have tried the country, we've been trying to figure out where to draw that line. And I would argue that the line is kind of moving. That's the part of the problem is, you know, I come back to it. Is hate speech free speech? Yes or no? And if it's not, then we have to define it. What constitutes hate speech? And that's, you know, good luck figuring that out. That's almost impossible.
You know, we have to wrap it up and you'll come back and I'll give you the last word. And we didn't even touch the surface of, because your introduction was so long. Money, Citizens United.
Defenestration.
Yes, Citizens United, they tell us that money is speech. If money is speech, everything is speech. And heckling is speech. And saying to Ann Coulter, you can't come on my campus, is speech. Everything is protected. The First Amendment protects everything. If money is speech, then I'm free to spend my money any way I want. And Ann Coulter is getting $20,000 to speak at Berkeley. She's not being paid by Berkeley. She's being paid by right-wing provocateurs who could have chosen any place on earth to pay her $20,000 to speak. And they chose Berkeley because Milo Yiannopoulos tried to speak there in February or January, and a riot broke out. And that's what the right wing wants to do. They want to create a riot on campus in Berkeley. And I'm looking at what's going on with the Trump administration and the EPA being denuded of its regulatory rights. And I'm thinking, do I really need to be discussing this cow, this bulimic, hateful, barren, half-human, half-harpy, wanting to speak on the campus at Berkeley? I thought we destroyed her on the Comedy Central roast. Why is she rearing her ugly butt? And why are we discussing her? I'm so
tired. Tell me how you really feel, man.
I'm so tired of this First Amendment argument. You know what it is? It's an argument for people who are lazy. It's a lazy argument. There's a tax plan that has to be addressed. There is a Russian oligarch who is taking over our election, and we're still discussing whether or not Ann Coulter has the right to speak at Berkeley. Who cares?
Yeah, but okay, I can agree with everything you just said, but to me it's like the solution to this problem is not that we should therefore censor her. It's just we shouldn't talk about it. Let them try to be provocateurs. Who is deciding that this is a news story that is going to end up on the front page of Yahoo News?
Lazy people like me who lazy people like me who have Trump fatigue, and they have to do, and I have to do a show. I have to do this show, and when I read about the tax plan, I get so depressed. The only thing that energizes me is Ann Coulter. It's lazy. Gotcha. It's lazy.
Okay, well then, that laziness is what we should be banning, not the right to speak. I mean, I'm a huge free speech advocate. So my argument has always been, I became sold on this in law school, in fact, which is that the solution to bad speech, even hateful speech, is not less speech. It's more speech. You don't like Ann Coulter. You know, if the right wing and the alt-right are putting all these provocateurs in place and implementing this effective strategy to get more awareness around what they're doing and create, you know, situations by provoking either a riot or a negative response by a university, which then leads to a news story, where is the counter voice? Where are the people organizing speakers on campuses to refute them, to debate these people, to, you know, shame them for the racist that they are? Where is that narrative? It's like, it's so much easier to call for the banning of a book or the burning of a book than it is to write the counter narrative.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel like, yeah, it is laziness. And I'm sort of sick of social justice warriors that want to complain about how bad the alt-right is and how they're... It's like, you know what? They're producing these quack public intellectuals. Where's the countervailing voices? You don't like what they're saying? Refute them in the public open marketplace of ideas. I wish there was more energy put into crafting and articulating convincing counterarguments and counter figures than there is put into just, you know, rah, 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 screaming and shouting and yelling and trying to shout down people.
I mean, in this country, how often are you asked to appear on mainstream media to give a rational legal opinion?
Not very often.
And yet you're a lawyer and a comedian.
Correct.
Right.
Yeah, I mean that there you go. I mean, it's you also know this, you're a smart guy. All the mass media, pretty much, you know, in the United States and really now around the world, is just consistently getting consolidated slowly but surely into the hands of a handful of conglomerates that own all the film studios, all the TV channels, all the radio stations, all the newspapers, all the magazines, all the book publishers, all the billboard companies. It's in the hands of a few people, man. So the narrative becomes so, you know, narrow. And I'm sure you know the stats. I mean, Trump was given over $5 billion of free advertising, free media. Well, whose decision was that? It's not the public that's deciding that. You know, it's because executives at media corporate media entities know that Trump, as much as the hateful as the shit that he says is, he's good for business, you know? When Trump brags about my ratings are great, you know, he's not talking about Celebrity Apprentice. He means when I'm on your channel, you're going to make money. He recently, did you know he recently said the ratings had never been as high, since the towers fell? He said that a couple days ago. He's comparing himself to 9/11. That's a real thing. It's insane. But that's what it is, man. These guys are making money, man. CNN, you know, Fox News, etc. You know, they all make money off Trump. They air commercials. When he this weekend he's going to be doing that Pennsylvania rally, while the White House Correspondents Dinner is happening, they're all going to be there. Their cameras are going to be rolling. Uh-huh. They're going to be cutting to commercials, and they're going to be making money. So that's also real. Nobody wants to talk about that. The so-called left-wing, you know, liberal media, the content of what you're saying might be critiquing Trump, but you're still talking about fucking Trump. Mm-hmm. And Kellyanne Conway and Spicer and. Like, it's just a circus, man.
Right.
We're living in a reality show, my friend.
Well, there have to be twists and turns, and it's a reality show. It's also this ongoing Perry Mason. There's a Law and Order factor in that we keep thinking now he's caught. Oh no, he's not. Now he's caught.
I mean, it's so absurd because it's like, what else? What, he's already done enough evil shit that should have tanked him. The guy is Teflon, man. He said it himself. I could shoot a guy in the middle of Manhattan and my ratings would go up.
It's not
approval rating go up.
It's not Teflon. It's like a document dump. When you know, when the White House doesn't want you to find something at the, or in a lawsuit, you just pile the opposing counsel with discovery, thousands and thousands of documents. They get bogged down going through it, and they can't even see the crime. There is a document dump going on with Trump in that everybody he surrounds himself with is a criminal. So at what point? You don't even know where to begin to prosecute. And that is really how an autocracy, a kleptocracy works. That's how a Latin American banana republic works, is that everybody is corrupt, which means that nobody's corrupt.
Yeah, man, it's so depressing. I agree with you 100%. I mean, the other benefit of, you know, if you know more about just the rest of the world, I think that there's a, you know, the myth of American exceptionalism that most Americans either consciously or unconsciously just drink up because, you know, since you're a kid in this country, you're brainwashed into this idea that America's the greatest country in the world, America's the greatest country in the world. And if you really believe it, you start to think that, no, we're different. The rest of the world operates, you know, in this very corrupt way, but we're different. And Trump is just sort of like the guy who just pulled back the curtain and he was like, no, we're not that different.
We're not that different.
Yeah, people, we do the same thing as everyone else.
We do, you know, and we accept one indignity after another. This is a country that is ruled, like you said, by a handful of people, and their objective is to suck up as much money as possible. We all think, we're convinced, we're a nation of laws until we go through the criminal justice system or the court system or the family law system, and you discover, no, we're a nation of lawyers, not laws, lawyers.
Right. Yeah, it's true.
But
here's the thing. I don't want to come across. Look, here's what I've concluded about this. You know, we all kind of have this ideal in our minds, how we imagine things ought to be, this society of law and order and perfect justice and, you know, a total meritocracy and everybody is judged based on the content of their character and, you know, you get ahead in life because you work hard and you have integrity and that's how the society should work. And we imagine that, wouldn't it be great if that we could live in a world like that? And that's great. That's a wonderful dream. But nobody gets that. That's never existed in human history. And so the idea is to maintain that ideal and just keep chipping towards, you know, towards it and trying to get better. So I'm saying to you that America is actually, you know, far less corrupt, in my belief, than certain other societies on the earth. And at the same time, it is not, I don't believe in blanket, you know, unqualified American exceptionalism as though America is just, you know, above above any wrongdoing. You know, our foreign policy. I mean, so many aspects of the way our country is working, and especially now, it's gotten just more grotesque. You know, there's always been conflicts of interest being a president, but it's never been like this. This guy is a multi-billionaire global businessman who, out of one side of their mouth, they hate on globalists. You know, it's so funny to me. I wrote a joke about this. Like, I will literally go to my grave never understanding Trump supporters who would go around saying, you know, we got to do something about these goddamn billionaires, you know, taking over our country. We got to take our country back from these goddamn globalist multinational billionaires. And that's why I'm going to vote for a global multinational billionaire. What the fuck are you talking about, dude? Like, this guy is exactly the guy you hate. Like, it makes absolutely zero rational, logical sense. Complaints are valid.
Let me ask you this.
They chose the wrong guy.
Let me ask you this. God has a sense of humor. History is funny.
Yes.
What if Donald Trump turns out to be the most transparent president we've ever had? In that, hang on for one second. We know everything about him.
Yes.
He's an open book. Except for his taxes, he's pretty much an open book, right? Except for his taxes.
Yeah, fair point.
And I have a feeling the reason he's not releasing his taxes is it'll be boring. Just like he wants to wave that in front of everybody as a distraction. And there's probably nothing in there. I don't really believe that.
I have a theory.
All right, I'm just hypothesizing. But let me just say one thing, and then you can tell your theory. My beloved Barack Obama is getting $400,000 to speak at Cantor Fitzgerald. Now, Cantor Fitzgerald was one of the stock trading firms that was decimated after 9/11. They have $400,000 to give to Barack Obama. I would rather that money goes to the first responders, the families of the first responders who are still suffering from breathing in that air. But Cantor Fitzgerald, which was almost wiped out after 9/11, is going to give Barack Obama $400,000 to speak. I love Barack Obama. He's on my team. But that doesn't smell right. That doesn't smell right for a liberal Democratic president who defeated Hillary Clinton because she was the one who took the money from Goldman Sachs. He should not be taking $400,000 from Cantor Fitzgerald, especially since Cantor Fitzgerald is linked to 9/11. And they should be giving that money to first responders. The point I'm making is Donald Trump could be the most transparent president we've ever had because he's just flaunting his corruption and his hypocrisy.
It's a fair point. I mean, he may very well be. I mean, did you see the interview he did with Bill O'Reilly right before the Super Bowl? Where O'Reilly asked him, do you respect Putin? And Trump says, yeah, I do. You know, he's a leader of a country. He leads this country. I respect him. And O'Reilly says, yeah, but he's a killer. You know, he's killed people. And Trump, I swear to God, Trump says this. He goes, you think we're so innocent?
Right.
We got a lot of killers here. Iraq war, this, that. I mean, it is stunning to watch a sitting president basically indicting the United States as being, you know, as corrupt as any other dictatorship or, you know, any other thug power on the world scene. That's shocking.
Yeah.
And it's also on the other hand, it's sort of like, well, he has a point.
He has a point. In Trump's America, even a broken clock is right 24 hours a day. Is that funny?
That's a good flip. I like it.
I just made that clever up.
I like taking like hacky sounding old jokes.
Uh-huh.
If you could flip it.
Hold on,
but I want to give you a theory about the tax return thing.
Okay.
Did you know that when Trump was roasted on Comedy Central,
I was there. I wrote it.
Okay. Oh, you wrote it. So then you know that the one rule. What was the one rule that you guys were given? You can't joke about how much he says he's worth.
Yeah. I'll tell you something else. You want to know something else?
Of course I do. Please.
He was supposed to give all that money to charity. And we never found out what the charity was. He never proved, this is what I've heard, he allegedly never informed us where that money went.
Interesting.
So he said the money was going to charity.
Did you guys pay him in rubles?
Well, we have to, hey, listen, you're my new best friend. You're my new best friend.
I'm a big fan of yours.
I have a prepared outro.
Let's do it. Hold on, but you can't finish right now because I hinted at a can of worms and we never finished it. And I don't want to piss off any of your listeners.
What was the can of worms?
Well, you know, I said there's two conversations in America that Trump winning has forced on America. White America needs to have a conversation about the history and legacy of slavery in this country so that white liberals can get over the white guilt and we can have a constructive conversation. And because we know how the right wing feels about slavery. They're like, yeah, let's bring it back. But I feel like the left in this country is so unable to process their white guilt, and it's really a hindrance towards making true progress. And the second conversation, which is what I hinted at when I said Israel, when I brought up Israel, mm-hmm. is the fact, and I'm saying this as somebody who grew up with Jewish people. So this is not coming.
Are you saying some of your best friends are Jews? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, exactly. Okay. I'm using a stock line from racists because America needs to start having a conversation with herself, and Jews in America need to help this conversation happen, which is that critique of Israeli right-wing violent Zionist policies that are represented by only a fringe radical within Israeli politics. Critiquing that is not anti-Semitism. Please, let's stop this nonsense.
Okay, we have to wrap it up because this is. I have a Muslim on my show who is making sense, and he's cogent and convincing, and knows what he's talking about. So we have to cut you off.
Fair enough. I understand. I understand how it works.
Yeah, and now you're also bridging the gap between Jews and Muslims in America. That doesn't further the cause of perpetual debate in order to do
from one mensch to another, my friend.
Yeah, you know, I can't. On my show, it's a constant debate. And if you're talking about what we have in common and our similarities and how we can all work together towards justice and peace, that's not entertaining. This show has to be about fighting and debating and arguing and name calling. So we have to.
Well, I'm also a member of ISIS. We didn't finish that. Get to card carry.
So now, but here I have my standard closing is this, because this makes me sound good, okay? Because I'm Jewish and you're a Muslim.
Yes, sir.
Ready? No, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to call you my brother. I'm not going to say brother. I'm not going to call you my brother. I'm going to call you my sister.
Fair enough. Just a construct.
All right, let me just wrap this up. This is the part. I got this down by the numbers. I've been doing this for so long. Now I start calling you my brother because then it endears me to you and the audience, and I sound very, you know, like I'm all about peace, brother. Okay, brother?
Sounds good, brother.
Okay, brother. So, brother, tomorrow night we should all watch the White House Correspondents Dinner. My brother Hassan Minhaj will be telling jokes to my brothers at the White House Correspondents Dinner. Right, brother?
I think that's right. I think there might be some sisters there and maybe some people who are them.
Right, brother. And, brother, where can people see you do comedy, brother?
Brother, I am doing stand-up sets at the Cellar in Manhattan this week, and I am based out of Chicago. I have a monthly show called In Polite Company, a political comedy show about race, religion, and politics at the Chicago Laugh Factory every month. People can check all that out on my website, which is azhar.com, A-Z-H-A-R.com.
Brother, can you spell your full name, brother?
I will, brother. It's spelled D-A-V-I-D-F-E-L-D-M-A-N.
That's my name, brother.
Oh, my God. We're so close. I sometimes forget who's who. My name is spelled Azhar. A-Z as in zebra, H-A-R.com.
And, brother, how do people follow you on Facebook and Twitter?
the links are actually on that website. Twitter handle is just my full name, Azhar Usman, A-Z-H-A-R-U-S-M-A-N. It's like U.S. man. Mm-hmm. And they can just search my name on Facebook and find the fan page as well.
Hey, brother, man, let's do the bit that we talked about doing at the top of the show, brother.
Sounds good, brother.
No, do the bit.
What bit? What was the bit?
But why you're on Skype.
Why I'm on Skype?
Why are we doing this interview on Skype?
Oh, yeah, right. I reached out to you, let you know I was back in Manhattan. We had been trying to get this thing scheduled.
That's right, brother.
So given that I'm in New York, I said, hey, man, let's do it. And you said, I can't be in the same room as you, so let's do it over Skype. That's pretty much the way it went down, right?
Right, brother. I mean, you understand, brother, that...
Brother, I get it. Who are you talking to?
You're in the room next door.
You know, defenestration is required.
But you understand, brother. You understand that even though we're different, you understand where I'm coming from, where I cannot be in the same room with you.
I get it. I do understand. I mean,
even though you're next door, we have to do it via Skype, brother, because you respect my values, brother, right?
100%, yeah. And you got to be careful who you're seen with, you know what I mean? And like a picture with me, NSA, you know, they're watching, you know, it's... So. I'm just letting you know, by the way, coming on your show, you've been added to probably a few lists.
Okay, brother. But by the way, if we run into each other in the hall, brother, I don't make eye contact, brother, and I don't want to ride in the same elevator with you, brother. You understand where I'm coming from, brother, don't you?
Brother, I'm hoping that the brother bit is holding up, brother. I'm hoping your listeners are like, why is he continuing? Why?
Hey, how long are you in town, brother?
Well, brother, I don't even know at the moment. I'm either flying home tomorrow or I'm here for another few days.
Okay.
I might get a gig in Long Island or whatever.
Okay. I would have coffee with you, brother, but we'll have to do it via Skype.
We'll do it. I'll be back.
You understand, brother.
No, we should have dinner sometime, man. Let's just make sure we do it over Google Hangout.
I love you.
That's awesome.
Thank you.
I'll take it. Hey, Feldman, thanks for having me on,
thanks
man.
For doing it, man. Thank you, sir.
Peace, man.
Bye.